and all participants. On behalf of the organizing team, myself, Dr. Mohua Sheth, Faculty Department of Physiology, Hiralal Mojumdar Memorial College for Women, warmly welcome you all to the one-day state-level webinar on Corona Paradox of the COVID-19, jointly organized by IQSC and Department of Physiology, Hiralal Mojumdar Memorial College for Women, in association with Department of Physiology, West Bengal State University. The outbreak of coronavirus disease 2019 has created a global health crisis that has had a deep impact on the way we perceive our world and our everyday lives. This highly infectious respiratory disease has spread rapidly across the world. The World Health Organization, in the month of February 2020, has declared COVID-19 as a public health emergency of international concern. It is a historic pandemic disease. It is highly fatal and takes the world as storm. The causative agent is SARS coronavirus 2, which produces serious health crises throughout the world. In terms of virulence and structure, it is a total new virus. Its nature is not completely known to us. It can mutate itself for many times. This unknown nature of the virus and unavailability of specific medicine or vaccine force us to stand behind the closed doors. So, we need awareness. We need to obstruct the velocity of human-to-human transmission as well as transmission through contaminated surfaces or objects. Social distancing and avoiding mass gatherings are primarily necessary to avoid the trouble of the virus attack. All the health advisories must be followed affirmatively to deal with this deadly pandemic, the future of which is still a mystery. Today, we have with us our eminent speakers, Professor Shyamal Roy, Professor and Dean, National Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research, Kolkata, and Professor Pratiti Ghosh, Professor and Head, Department of Physiology, West Bengal State University, who will enlighten us with their valuable perspectives. Now, I would like to request Dr. Amrita Banerjee, Assistant Professor and Head, Department of Chemistry, Hiralal Mojumdar Memorial College for Women, to host the inaugural session of today's webinar. Over to Amrita.
Thank you, Mohadi. Am I audible, Mohadi?
Yes, you are audible, Amrita.
Okay, thank you. I once again take this opportunity to welcome you formally in today's inaugural session. I would now request our respected principal madam, Dr. Shoma Ghosh, our respected speakers, Professor Pratiti Ghosh and Professor Shyamal Roy, and our IQSC coordinator, Dr. Rupa Sen, to inaugurate the webinar by lighting the lamp in this virtual platform. Thank you. I now request our Honorable Principal, Dr. Shoma Ghosh, to deliver the welcome address. Ma'am, please. Hello, ma'am. I request our principal ma'am, Dr. Shoma Ghosh, to kindly deliver the welcome address.
Yeah, Amrita, madam, ওই কোন ফোনের সমস্যার কথা বলছিলেন,
ওকে
একবার একটু যোগাযোগ করে দেবে?
ওকে শিওর 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 রূপাদি মোহানি, কুড ইউ কানেক্ট ম্যাম?
Yes, sir. Sir couldn't able to join the meeting. You have to give the access to him.
Oh, sure, sure. I request Athri or Pooja to please confirm the request of Dr. Shamol Roy, sir. He is unable.
Did you tell us no request received yet?
Okay.
Do you follow me?
Yes, yes, yes.
Sir couldn't able to join the meeting. You have to give the access to him so that
okay so acha I am requesting our technical team. I think if it is possible for him to resend the request once more.
Yes. He needs the,
you have to give me access to join the meeting
because it is written over there.
It is written.
You will, asking to join.
You will join the call when someone lets you in.
Yes, yes, sir. I think due to some technical issues, the request has not yet reached our technical team. Can you please resend the request once more? Can you please leave and join once more? I have already delivered the message to our technical team. Pooja and Athri, please check once whether you are getting any request from sir.
No, there is no request yet.
Okay, I have asked him, I have requested him to leave and join once, but he is saying that he is getting the message asking to join, but then he cannot get the access.
Yes,
Did the link happen sent to sir's email? As he has been added in the host list, so if he joins from that link, he doesn't need any permission to join.
If he gets the link, then he needs to just click the yes button in the mail. After clicking the yes button, then if he clicks the link, then he will get the join the meeting automatically.
Okay, sure. I am conveying. Hello ma'am, can you please request sir to join the link from his email? That is the host links, and permission is not required. He can just click yes and join from his email, the link which has been sent. Yes sir,
what it is telling here, you will join the call when someone lets you in.
Yes sir, but no, sir. The host
Amrita, this is principal. I couldn't access my internet, so I am accessing it through.
Sir, is there any option which is telling you that you can join yes or no if you click that yes option in your email link?
No, it's not seen over there in the screen.
Okay, so Athri or Pooja, can you share the link in this chat box once more so that ma'am can just forward it to sir any WhatsApp number or so if it is possible? Athri, please can you share today's link?
Yes,
98745. WhatsApp থেকে এটা পসিবল কি মানে
অমৃতা দি? অমৃতা দি,
হ্যাঁ ইয়েস, হ্যাঁ হ্যালো, হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ
আমি সোমা,
হ্যাঁ
মোহা, প্লিজ সেন্ড দ্য লিংক টু অমৃতা দিস WhatsApp. ওকে,
ইয়েস ইয়েস, আই এম টেলিং দ্যাট ওয়ান.
And Amrita ji will send it to sir.
Yes, I am saying that only, ma'am.
I'm
accessing Pradeep's mobile. Okay, Pradeep's net. So I'm not visible over there.
No, no. Sir is sending his Gmail number.
Okay.
Roy.Shamul.
Atri, please note.
Roy.Shamul. SYAMAL. 72@gmail.com. Okay, do you follow me?
Yes, ma'am. We have sent the mail.
I'm repeating again. Roy.Shamul, SYAMAL, 72@gmail.com. Okay.
Okay, ma'am. We are sending it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ma'am, should we wait till Samuel Royce joins?
Ma'am,
you have to share the link
for a while. If in time, I'd like to request Dr. Rupa Sen, IQAC coordinator, to welcome all the honored guests and speakers and the participants from the end of the college, because I'm accessing someone else's mobile and I'll be on in the road, so I may not get access. I request Dr. Rupa Sen, IQAC coordinator, to welcome all the dignitaries and the participants in this webinar.
Okay, ma'am. So I request our IQAC coordinator, Dr. Rupa Sen, to formally deliver the welcome address. Rupadi, over to you.
Thank you. Good evening and a warm welcome to all our dignitaries, to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, our distinguished speakers, Professor Shamul Roy, Dean, National Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research, Dr. Pratiti Ghosh, Professor and Head, Department of Physiology, West Bengal State University, friends, dear students, and all other participants who have expressed their eagerness in attending our webinar this evening on Corona Paradox of COVID-19, jointly organized by IQAC unit of our college, the Department of Physiology of our college again, in association with the Department of Physiology, West Bengal State University. Once again, we have all joined to engage into a pedagogic exercise and get some information, to hear some discussion on this virus, coronavirus, that has taken a toll on us worldwide. And we are now trying to get an edge over it, trying to overcome it. We are hearing that the second phase of this COVID-19 is just around the corner, and we just do not know what to do. The whole scenario is so uncertain, and we are finding ourselves so frustrated and helpless. Anyways, I guess we will be hearing a lot more from our distinguished speakers today, and interesting note from our Honorable Vice Chancellor as well. So without further delay, I would just, on behalf of our principal, Dr. Shoma Ghosh, request Dr. Mohua Sheikh, head of the Department of Physiology of our college, to begin the session.
Thank you, Rupati.
And I am requesting Dr. Amrita Banerjee to continue the inaugural session of today's webinar. Over to Amrita.
Dr. Shamal Raj has not yet received his email. To look into the matter.
Oh, host. Okay, ma'am. I'm looking into the matter.
To my Gmail account. I need the connection with Gmail account.
Sir, we have sent a mail to Gmail account. We have again sent a host mail to Gmail account from where you don't need any permission to join, sir.
Okay, now it has come. Okay, thank you. Just came.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, hope now our technical issues will be resolved and sir will be able to join us in a short while. So we have so with kind permission from all our esteemed speakers and principal madam, I am proceeding with the session. So we have Professor Protiti Ghosh, Professor and Head, Department of Physiology, West Bengal State University, with us today. Not only as one of the esteemed speakers, but also as the collaborator who has extended her cooperation and active support for organizing today's webinar. Thank you very much, madam. I invite you to deliver today's inaugural speech. Ma'am, please.
Good evening, Honorable Professor Bashuk Chaudhuri sir, Professor Shamal Roy sir, Dr. Shoma Ghosh, Dr. Mohua Sheth, my colleagues, scholars, students, and all other webinar attendees. I myself feel extremely honored to be a part of the seminar with Professor Shamal Roy, presently affiliated to NIPER. I extend a heartfelt welcome on behalf of Department of Physiology, West Bengal State University, to you all in this COVID-19 webinar, which will primarily encompass all its aspects to enrich ourselves with the knowledge of the current pandemic, with extension into the possibilities of tackling it as per the human range of intervention and acceptance of the consequences. Once again, I welcome you all to this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Hello, Amrita. Are you? Hello, Amrita. Amrita, are you here?
So, our VC sir has not yet joined. So, we will just delay the watering of the plants a bit and we will just proceed with it when VC sir joins us. So, meanwhile, I would request our IQ. Huh? Yes, ma'am, say.
VC sir is also traveling to reach his home. So,
okay,
he will be a bit late. Okay. You just proceed with the session.
Okay, ma'am. I would... Now, request Mohuadi to take over to proceed with the technical session.
Thank you, Amrita. Now we are going to start the technical session. In our technical session one, our honorable speaker is Professor Shyamal Roy, Professor and Dean, National Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research, Kolkata. At first, I am requesting Srimati Munmun Kundu, Faculty, Department of Botany, to formally introduce Professor Roy. Over to Munmun.
Thank you, Mohadi. Good evening, everyone. It is a great honor for me to introduce eminent scientist Professor Shyamal Roy. Presently, he is the Professor and Dean of National Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research, Ministry of Chemical and Fertilizers, Government of India. He was the former Vice Chancellor of Kuch Bihar Panchanan Burma University. Professor Roy got his PhD degree in biochemistry from the Indian Institute of Chemical Biology, University of Calcutta in 1983. He gathered his postdoctoral research experience at Massachusetts Institute of Technology, Cambridge, Mass, USA from 1985 to 1989. Professor Roy was the former chief scientist of CSIR, Indian Institute of Chemical Biology, from 1990 to 2016. His contributions have been recognized by many honors and awards. In 1976, he was honored and awarded with gold medal from University of Calcutta. And also he was awarded with Arthritis Foundation Fellowship Award from Massachusetts Institute of Technology in 1986. He was a member of Indian delegation UNGO US Vaccine Action Program at NIH Bethesda, USA in 1994. United Nations Development Project Fellow of Cornell University Medical Center in January 1995. Ekimukherjee Memorial Oration from the Physiological Society of India, Kolkata in 2003. With the Memorial Oration from the Calcutta School of Tropical Medicine, Kolkata in 2005. Senior Immunologist Oration from Indian Immunology Society, PGI, Chandigarh in 2005. Rajendra Memorial Oration from Rajendra Memorial Research Institute, ICMR, Patna in 2008. A.N. Bhaduri Oration from Society of Biological Chemists, India, Calcutta, Chapter in 2011. A.G. Dutta Oration from Kalyani University, Kalyani, West Bengal in 2012. U.C. Goswami Oration from the Department of Zoology, Guwahati University in 2016. And Fellow of West Bengal Academy of Science and Technology, the J.S. Fellow of Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. Fellow of Indian Academy of Science, Fellow of Indian National Science Academy, Fellow of the National Academy of Sciences. His major research interest is host-pathogen interaction in Leishmania. Today, Professor Roy will enlighten us on paradise loss to paradise regain, a long haul to know many unknowns of COVID-19.
I would just apologize for a little bit of mistake which we have done due to this technical issues. There is a short objective which would be delivered by our IQSC coordinator, Dr. Rupa Sen. I am extremely sorry for the mistake. So I would once again kindly request Dr. Rupa Sen to deliver the objective of the webinar before requesting our esteemed speaker, Dr. Shyamal Roy, to deliver his speech.
Yeah, you should proceed. Okay. Mohadi?
Rupadi? Rupadi, are you there? Dr. Rupa Sen? Rupadi? Rupadi, are you there?
Me? Can you hear me?
Yes.
You are audible.
Yes, Rupadi, you are audible. Yeah. Fully audible.
Okay.
Rupadi, please.
Okay. Shubho Shondha. আজকের ওয়েবিনারের শুভেচ্ছা ওয়েবিনার কে শুভে আজকের ওয়েবিনারের শুভেচ্ছা জানাই। বর্তমানে COVID-19 আমাদের দৈনন্দিন জীবনকে যে বিপর্যস্ত করে তুলেছে তা আমরা সকলেই হাড়ে হাড়ে টের পাচ্ছি। ব্যক্তিগত স্তরে বা সম্প্রদায়গতভাবে কোথাও স্বস্তি নেই। চূড়ান্ত অনিশ্চয়তার মুখে দাঁড়িয়ে অগণিত মানুষ হতাশার অতল অন্ধকারে যেন ক্রমশ ক্ষয় হয়ে চলেছে। প্রধানত দুটি দিক থেকে এই মারণ ভাইরাস আমাদের আক্রমণ করে বসেছে, এক স্বাস্থ্য আর দ্বিতীয়ত অর্থনৈতিক। আর এই দুই ক্ষেত্রেই আজ মানুষকে ব্যক্তিগত, জাতীয় এবং বিশ্ব জগতের স্তরে অস্থির করে তুলেছে। মানুষের বাঁচতে প্রয়োজন বায়ু, বাঁচতে হলে প্রয়োজন জল, খাদ্য। অথচ এই ভাইরাস এই স্তরেই আক্রমণ করে বসেছে, ফলে বহু মানুষ ফ্লুইড কম্প্রোমাইজিং লাং ফাংশনের কারণে ভালো করে নিঃশ্বাসটুকু নিতে পারছেন না। অনেকেই বিভিন্ন ব্যাধির দ্বারা পূর্বেই আক্রান্ত, অনেকের বার্ধক্য চলেছে, যাদের নিত্য স্বাস্থ্যের পরিচর্যা প্রয়োজন, চাই আইসিইউ, চাই ভেন্টিলেশন। ভ্যাকসিন এখনো দূরস্থ, ওষুধ যা ব্যবহার হচ্ছে তা সবই অনুমানের ভিত্তিতে, কারণ এই রোগ বা জীবাণু বা তার পথ্য কোনো বিষয়ে কারোরই এখনো অবধি সঠিক ধারণা নেই। সরকার তাদের মতন স্বাস্থ্য পরিষেবা দেওয়ার চেষ্টা করছেন, কারোর কাছে সেটা আশানুরূপ হচ্ছে, কারোর কাছে নয়। তার উপরে রয়েছে গণমাধ্যম এবং তাদের অভিনব আইডিয়াস অফ আইসোলেশন অ্যান্ড কোঅপারেশন। এই যে অতিমারী আমাদের ভীত সন্ত্রস্ত করে রেখেছে সর্বক্ষণ, প্রতিনিয়ত আমাদেরকে স্মরণ করাচ্ছে যে আমরা মরণশীল। সামান্য অবহেলা কিন্তু বড় মাশুল দিতে হতে পারে, যেতে হতে পারে পর পারে। জীবনকে হ্যাঁ একদিকে কিন্তু মানে যে যেমন আমরা এই দিকটা বুঝতে পারছি দ্যাট উই আর মর্টাল, কিন্তু অন্যদিকে আমাদের ভীষণভাবে তথ্যনিষ্ঠ হতে শিখিয়েছে। জীবনকে বাঁচিয়ে রাখার অদম্য প্রয়াস শক্তি জুগিয়ে চলেছে। কি করলে নিরাপদ ও সুস্থ থাকা যায় এই নিয়ে আমরা সব সময় ভেবে চলেছি। আসলে স্বাস্থ্যই সম্পদ একথা মুখে বললেও কজন আর তা মনে রাখেন, ফলে স্বাস্থ্য বিষয়টা এনিগমেটিক হয়ে পড়ে, একটা ধোঁয়াশা। স্বাস্থ্য হারালে আমাদের বোধোদয় হয়, সময়ের এক ফোর অসময়ের দশ ফোরেও যে কাজ দেয় না সেটা আমরা ভুলে যাই। কিন্তু ওই যে মরণকালে হরির নাম করাটাই আমাদের মজ্জায়। গত মার্চ থেকে ভারতীয়রা অতিমারির প্রকোপে মানে অন্যান্য বিশ্বের অন্যান্য প্রান্তের মানুষের সঙ্গে ভারতীয়রা অতিমারির প্রকোপে বিপর্যস্ত হয়েছে। কিন্তু জীবন তো আর থেমে থাকে না, তাই ঘরের বাইরে যেতে অসুবিধা থাকলেও ঘরের ভেতর থেকে বিকল্প রাস্তায় সমস্ত কাজ সম্পন্ন করার উপায় সন্ধান করতে গিয়ে আমরা আমাদের দৈনন্দিন জীবনকে দিব্যি ডিজিটালাইজ করে ফেলেছি। বিভিন্ন যান্ত্রিক সাধনে পরস্পরের সঙ্গে যোগাযোগ থেকে শুরু করে অফিসের কাজ, বিকিনি, এমনকি ছেলে মেয়েদের লেখাপড়া সবই চলছে অনলাইন ডিজিটালি। সুবিধে অসুবিধে সে কথা না হয় বাদই দিলাম, আমরা নতুন পরিস্থিতির সঙ্গে মানিয়ে জীবন রথ চালিয়ে নিয়ে যাওয়ার আপ্রাণ চেষ্টা করে চলেছি। তো এর কতগুলো প্যারাডক্স আমাদের প্রায়ই কিন্তু চোখে পড়ছে। যেমন যেটা বললাম যে আমরা ডিজিটালাইজ হয়ে পড়ছি, আমরা যান্ত্রিকতার ওপরে বেশি বড্ড বেশি গুরুত্ব দিয়ে ফেলছি, সবটাই এখন ভার্চুয়ালি হচ্ছে, সুতরাং আমাদের এক্সিস্টেন্সটাও যেন ভার্চুয়াল হয়ে গেছে। এটা কতটা আমাদের সপক্ষে যাবে বা যাচ্ছে জানি না, কিন্তু সবটাই যে ভালো হচ্ছে না সেটা বেশ বোঝা যাচ্ছে। আরেকটা দিক হচ্ছে মেলামেশা থেকে দূরে থাকা, দ্যাট ইজ দ্য প্যারাডক্স অফ আইসোলেশন। সামাজিক দূরত্ব অবলম্বন করছি যাতে কোভিড-19 আক্রান্ত না হই, তাতে আবার নিঃসঙ্গতা গ্রাস করছে, মনস্তাত্ত্বিক সমস্যা তৈরি হচ্ছে, আবাল বৃদ্ধা বনিতা গৃহবন্দী দশায় ক্রমে ক্রমে অন্য মানুষ হয়ে উঠছে, হিংস্রতা বাড়ছে লাফিয়ে লাফিয়ে। এখন এই যে সামাজিক দূরত্ব, তার মানে তো এটা নয় যে আমরা কারোর কাছাকাছি যাব না, কিছু এ করবো না, এটা নয়। এটাকে আমার মনে হয় অনেকটাই কিন্তু ভুল ইন্টারপ্রিটেশন হচ্ছে। আমরা কোনো গ্যাদারিং এ সেইভাবে সামিল হব না, সীমিত সংখ্যক গিয়ে যদি কোনো কাজ মিটে যায় সেটারই চেষ্টা করব। তার মানে এটা নয় যে একে ছোবো না, ওকে ওর বাড়িতে যাবই না, ইট ইজ নট লাইক দ্যাট। এই বিষয়গুলো কিন্তু আমাদেরকে ক্রমশ অসামাজিকই করে তুলছে। আর একটা দিক আমার খুব চোখে পড়েছে, দ্যাট ইজ ইউনো প্রিভেনশন। দেখা যায় যে মিডিয়াম রিস্ক থেকে লো রিস্ক গ্রুপ এ যারা করোনা আক্রান্ত অনেক বেশি ঝুঁকি তৈরি করে, কারণ হাই রিস্ক পিপল তারা তো আইডেন্টিফাইড, তারা টেস্টেড, তারা আইসোলেটেড। তো কিন্তু এদেরকে আমরা কিন্তু অনেক সময় ধরি না, ছেড়ে রাখি। সেই জন্য যেটা দরকার সেটা হচ্ছে লার্জ স্কেল টেস্টিং, পরীক্ষা নিরীক্ষাটা আরো বিস্তারভাবে করতে হবে। অ্যাসিমটোমেটিক পেশেন্টসদেরকেও কিন্তু আমাদের কনসিডারেশনে নিতে হবে, কারণ অ্যাসিমটোমেটিক পেশেন্টসরা তারা নিজেরাও জানে না সিমটম কি, এবং চারপাশে যাদের সঙ্গে মেলামেশা করে তারাও বুঝতে পারে না, অথচ চুপড়ি সারে কিন্তু ভাইরাসটা পাস অন হয়ে যাচ্ছে। ভ্যাকসিন আছে কিন্তু এখনো তেমন করে তার ব্যবহার শুরু হয়নি। লার্জ স্কেল টেস্ট বা তার আইসোলেটিং দ্য ইনফেক্টেড ফ্রম দি আনইনফেক্টেড, ইউ নো, স্টে অ্যাট হোম ইজ নো সাবস্টিটিউট ফর টেস্ট অ্যান্ড আইসোলেশন। পরিবারের মধ্যে সবচেয়ে বেশি কিন্তু ছড়াচ্ছে এই ভাইরাস। স্টে অ্যাট হোম বাইরেটাকে নিরাপদ করে, কিন্তু ঘরের ভিতরটা সেটাকে, সেখানে তো বিপদ বাড়ছে। করোনা রোগীর রোদ প্রয়োজন, খোলা বাতাস প্রয়োজন, ঘরে ক্রস ভেন্টিলেশন প্রয়োজন, কিন্তু বাস্তবে আমরা কি দেখছি যে বাড়িতে করোনা আক্রান্ত রয়েছে, পেশেন্ট রয়েছে, সেই বাড়িকে পাড়া থেকে চাপ দিয়ে জানলা দরজা বন্ধ রাখতে বলছে। অনেকে আবার লজ্জা, লোক লজ্জার কারণেও কিন্তু ওই বন্দি দশায় জীবনযাপন করছে। সো ইউ সি, উই আর লকিং আওয়ার সেলস ওয়েন উই অ্যাকচুয়ালি নিড ফ্রেশ এয়ার। যারা সুস্থ তারা আক্রান্ত হওয়ার ভয়ে মাস্ক পরে চলছেন 24 ঘন্টা। দীর্ঘক্ষণ মাস্ক পরে থাকার ফলে কি হচ্ছে, আমরা তো মানুষ, আমরা কার্বন ডাইঅক্সাইড ইনহেল করি, অক্সিজেন ইনহেল করি আর কার্বন ডাইঅক্সাইড এক্সহেল করি, কিন্তু মাস্ক পরে থাকলে কার্বন ডাইঅক্সাইড ওখানেই কিন্তু একটা একটা অ্যামাউন্ট অফ কার্বন ডাইঅক্সাইড ইজ গেটিং স্টাক and we are inhaling that back again. So shei carbon dioxide ke jokhon shorirer bhetore abar probesh kore jacche carbon dioxide, tokhon seta thekeo kintu je khoti sommukhin amra hote cholechi seta niye kojon ar bhabchi. Ekhon to bachi, porer ta pore bhabbo, kintu porer tao je bipoder level kromosho bere choleche sei niye to amader odhikangshori hush nei. দীর্ঘদিন মানুষ প্রকৃতিকে ধ্বংস করেছে নিজের স্বার্থের উদ্দেশ্যে, আজ সেই প্রকৃতি যেন শোধ নিচ্ছে। মানুষ একটু বাতাস, একটু নিঃশ্বাস নেওয়ার জন্য সংগ্রাম করছে, নাক মুখ বেঁধে চলছে, আর সেই কারণেই হয়তো প্রকৃতি যেন অনেক বেশি স্বস্তিতে রয়েছে। এই ধরনের অনেকগুলো মানে কন্ট্রাডিকশন, মানে এটা করলে ভালো হয় কিন্তু আবার তার সঙ্গে আবার ওইটাও হবে যেটা আবার ভালো হবে না, এই কন্ট্রাডিকশন গুলো নিয়েই, যে প্যারাডক্স যেটাকে বলছে, সেটা নিয়েই আজকের ওয়েবিনার। এ ধরনের ওয়েবিনার গুলোতেই মনোজ্ঞ চর্চা হয়তো আমাদের কিছুটা হলেও চোখ খুলে দিতে সাহায্য করবে, এন্ড ইট উইল অ্যাকচুয়ালি হেল্প আস টু আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ড অ্যান্ড নেভিগেট দ্য ওয়েজ টু ওভারকাম দিস আনপ্রিসিডেন্টেড সিচুয়েশন। আমাদের তো করোনা ভাইরাস, ইট হ্যাজ ইউ নো ইট হ্যাজ কাম টু স্টে উইথ আস, অ্যান্ড উই হ্যাভ টু অ্যাডাপ্ট টু ইট, উই হ্যাভ টু অ্যাডাপ্ট টু দ্য সিচুয়েশন দ্যাট অ্যাডহিয়ার্স টু ইট। সো ইনস্টেড অফ প্যানিকিং, প্যানিক না করে লেটস ট্রাই অ্যান্ড থিঙ্ক অফ র্যাশনাল ওয়েজ টু ওভারকাম ইট, টু অ্যাটলিস্ট আমাদের নিজের প্রত্যেকের জীবনটাকে যেন একটু সুস্থ এবং স্বাভাবিক অবস্থায় রাখতে পারি, সেই দিকে যেন আমরা আমাদের চিন্তা ভাবনাগুলোকে এগিয়ে নিয়ে যেতে পারি। আর বেশি কিছু বলবো না, আমাকে মহুয়া অবজেক্টিভস বলতে বলেছিল, আমি জানি না কতদূর আমি কি বললাম, আমার এগুলো ভীষণভাবে মনে হয়েছে বলে শেয়ার করলাম। এনিওয়েজ আজকে আমরা অনেক বেশি মনোজ্ঞ আলোচনা শুনবো আমাদের বিশিষ্ট বক্তাদের থেকেই, তাদের মুখ থেকেই, সেই দিকেই আমরা অধীর আগ্রহে অপেক্ষা করে রয়েছি। সুতরাং ধন্যবাদ, থ্যাংক ইউ,
ধন্যবাদ, ধন্যবাদ রূপাদি, থ্যাংক ইউ রূপাদি, ওভার টু ইউ মুনমুনদি।
Thank you, Rupadi, for your valuable speech. And you have highlighted what we are facing nowadays and maybe in future. Thank you once again. Now I would like to request respected sir to start his presentation. I welcome you, sir.
Sir,
please unmute yourself. Unmute. Mohadi, sir, it to unmute kora ache ektu khane dekhi.
Ami dekhchi madam ke phone kore.
Hello.
Yes sir, you are audible, sir. Yes sir, you are audible.
Hello.
Yes sir, you are audible, sir. Sir, probably two devices are working altogether. You please mute one device. Yes sir, now you are fully audible, sir.
Okay, now
can
you see the screen?
Yes sir.
Okay, so let me start, okay? Okay.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes,
Hello.
Sir.
Okay. So let us start. So thank you very much. It's a pleasure and privilege to be part of this webinar. I hope also that's why I don't know whether they joined or not. So Master was my mentor when I was in Virginia, because I was in CSR Center. I was not aware of university. Business. Every time I call Basav from Kukira and get his advice. So therefore Basav is my mentor in that. So today I'm going to talk about. So in this connection I would like to also mention how I became interested in this situation. When I was in Kukira, I used to get out many times.
So some of you have masters in the body, you are born by body.
that is the seventh seal. The seventh seal, Batman is giving us access to the show. The cost of anxiety of our different beginnings is sitting in our mental landscape. So, in this movie, the character of Ben invited in the cave area in Spain, asked for pages. And meanwhile, that is it is trying to delay the process of intellectual development. So, meanwhile, Batman is very successful in that way to show that he calls for the anxiety of different types of intelligence. He is still very in our landscape. And this is an ultimate symbol of the AI resistance to the dynamics of fate. So, success is going to some extraordinary intelligence that impacted human history. It started with the devoting class, then smallpox, then tuberculosis, cholera, yellow fever, influenza. Now we have COVID-19. And we have survived every microbes to the evolution of our immune system. And we will survive this one too. So our immune system is kind of an adaptive system. And they are capable of mounting immune response to wide variety of pathogens. So therefore, we have to survive through many epidemics, and probably we will survive these epidemics as well. So, and why we are in this COVID situation, and why we are standing, this is a famous fantasy painting by a Japanese painter, and it came out in one of the issues of the emerging infectious diseases. And you can see that some tiny boats, at least tiny boats with some fishermen, and they are seeing the giant whale. So our situation, the COVID situation, our situation is more or less like that, because there is no medicine and there is no vaccine so far available to combat this kind of situation. So we are simply seeing the giant whale. We do not know what will be about it if any of the other waves of new waves of pandemics start coming over to us. So, in the nature issue, one of the nature issues, it was published that the majority of the infectious diseases are of animal origin. And if you look at the bottom, that rabies, Ebola, dengue, and HIV. They were at a point of time were restricted to the animal kingdom. And as we started mixing with the animal kingdom, many pathogens started to adapt to the human system. In the stage 2, it came from the animal to the human. And third stage, it came from animal to human, and then to human. And in the fourth stage, again animal to human. Fifth stage is from human to human. So we have a COVID situation. It's a keep one, stage keep, because it is simply human to human transmission, and therefore it is very difficult to control. Now, who discovered this coronavirus? The Scottish bus driver discovered the first human coronavirus. She was a lab technician in, I think, Imperial College in London. And then finally she moved to Canada and joined the Ontario Cancer Center. And there she discovered this virus. And you can see that these crown-like structures around the virus particles. So therefore, they call it coronavirus. And it is given in the BBC News sometimes back. So if you look at the structure of the coronavirus, and there are a lot of molecules on the surface, and they are called the spike proteins, and these spike proteins are important for interacting with the host cells. There are immense number of proteins in the surface. What is the spike protein? It is the nuclear protein, and it is the membrane protein. And also, it is another variety of protein present in the coronavirus. And vaccine target is the spike protein because it is highly related. So, therefore, this important vaccine candidate. Most of the vaccines coming from Oxford vaccine to many other vaccines. Spike protein is an important vaccine candidate. How did the virus enter the system? Lung cell, respiratory system, and many other symptoms. This top two is the virus. It has spike protein. And spike protein has a specific affinity for the cell surface receptor that is transmitted and you can see for binding enzyme 2 has a specific affinity. And this receptor is important very much in our blood pressure regulation. So selectively binds, spike protein binds to the AC2 receptor and then there is through some biochemical procedures and ultimately it enters into the host cell. So in cartoon, it has shown the interaction between the AC2 and the spike protein. You can see the yellow one is the spike protein receptor. This one part of the spike protein contains the receptor, and H2 is important for fusion with the host cells. And the right hand side, you can see the host cell membrane having the receptor of AC2. This specific interaction is important for entering the virus into the host cells. Then, this is the paper published in Nature Medicine sometime in March, where the entire sequence of this virus has been published. It's roughly about 29,000 aminas there in this virus. And out of the spike protein is roughly about 1285 amino acid sequences there. And you can see that this receptor binding domain, the structure is the red one, and this important structure polyfusion, and this is the only structure present in the COVID-19, which is absent in any other virus that we know. We will talk about it later. So, now if we align these SARS-CoV-2 sequences with other sequences like COVID-19, and all these sequences, they can see interestingly only again as the sequence that we see in the SARS-CoV-2. The unique sequence that is found in the SARS-CoV-2 NFUSNY, this is also present in the family of NFUSNY. This is the single letter code of the amino acid sequences. So, in all probability, the family the human CoV-2 virus probably received these sequences from active sequences, and these unique sequences is important for the host pathogen interaction. So another important sequence that is only present in human SARS-CoV-2 spike protein, if you look at the Wuhan sequences, TSS sequences, China sequences, Japan and USA sequences, and this killing decomposition model is a single letter. And this is only present in the SARS-CoV-2 or any other virus that you can think of. Not in rat sequences, not in pandemic or giant or any other sequences. This unique sequence is only present in the SARS-CoV-2 starting from Wuhan in the US and China and Japan. And this unique sequence is present. So, this is a specific motif and which is its characteristics of SARS-CoV virus, and this is the cell sign through which a lot of proteins work. Therefore, spike protein is clicked into S1 and S2, and a lot of proteins is present on the surface. And through this, all these proteases work through this motif and responsible for clearing this protein through S1 and S2. Now, so spike protein has been mapped. So spike protein SARS-CoV-2 Harvard's MRP basic this one is to sign. The hosts protease during each the SARS-CoV-2 spike protein and the S1 and S2 site. The leakage at the S1 and S2 site is essential for spike protein virus in the lung cells. So therefore, on this specific by the proteases, the virus will not be able to enter into the host cells. So what is the pathology? What kind of pathology is seen in progressive infection? So this is a single and duty in the lung, and virus has caught in the lung and duty. We can see two types of symptoms. One is very high, and some people are kind of having by the infection, they recover. But some people are showing about serious scale of infection. About 90% of the people recover by themselves, but about 50% of the people, they show the symptom of the severe disease. And what happens? That individual cells, when you encounter the virus, they produce a variety of cytokines. Often you will hear the current cytokine stop. And if disease progresses, then a lot of cytokines are produced, and that is called the cytokine storm. And which is responsible for the different organ damage and ultimately the location of the brain. So, can you see my PPT now? Hello?
Sir, your PPT are not visible, sir.
From the beginning or now?
Have you shown?
I have shared it.
It is not visible. I am requesting Pooja Ratri. Pooja Ratri, are you here? Yes, please look after the matter that the PPT presentation, PPT cells are not visible.
After
you click present now, sir, please select your entire screen. Three options will pop up. From there, select the topmost option, your entire screen.
Okay, I go to the entire screen. Then?
Yes, okay. Sir. Then you just select your screen. A screenshot of the screen will appear. select that and click on the share option. Yes, sir, it's visible. It's visible, sir. Now just click on your PowerPoint. Sir, now open your PowerPoint.
Now it is visible?
And sir, yes, sir. And start your slideshow. Sir, please click on the slideshow.
So now we can see. Hello?
Yes, sir. Left side, select the slideshow.
Left side, আছে বলে দাও উপরের দিকে
স্যার আপনি যেখানে ক্লিক করলেন ওর পাশেই দেখুন স্লাইড শোর একটা অপশন আছে যেখান থেকে আপনি টাইল করলেন স্যার হ্যাঁ ওটা ক্লিক করুন স্যার স্লাইড শো স্টার্ট হবে ইয়েস স্যার ইটস ভিজিবল স্যার
সরি নাও ক্যান ইউ সি Hello?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Stop sharing. Sir, you have to stop sharing.
Okay. I don't know that you are not.
Sir, again, please repeat the process. You have stopped sharing your screen. Sir, please click on the present now again.
The icon is not coming. I don't know what's the problem.
Sir, click on the present now option.
I'm looking for the icon and it's not coming.
Sir, just take your cursor upon the screen, that option will come. Present now will be shown on your screen. Sir, present now in your right hand corner bottom.
Yeah.
Sir, click on that.
To entire screen, right?
Yes, sir. Entire screen, then select the screen and share now. Yes, sir. And now just click on your PowerPoint, sir.
Problem is that my PowerPoint is kind of disappearing. I don't know.
দেখুন স্লাইড শো লেখা আছে ওটা একটু ক্লিক করে দিন পাশাপাশি রয়েছে পরের পরের মানে দুটো পরের আর কি
অ্যানিমেশন তো পরেই আছে স্লাইড শো
এর পরেরটাই স্যার এর পরেরটাই হ্যাঁ এখানে ক্লিক করে দিন স্যার
ফ্রম বিগিনিং স্যার স্যার এখানে নিচে ডান দিকে কোণায় উপরে ফ্রম বিগিনিং
বাদিকে
ফার্স্ট যে অপশনটা বাদিকে ফার্স্ট অপশনটা স্যার স্যার যেখানে স্লাইড শো ক্লিক করলেন ওর বাদিকে স্যার বাদিকে
হ্যালো
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Go and then. So I started with this slide, the Socratic paradox, that I know nothing, or I know that I don't know. I know that I know nothing, or I know one thing that I know nothing. So that's how I started. So then I talked about the concept of the paradise lost, how in the form of Saturn, how we are infected in the coronavirus. And whether any other wave of infection coming in the future or not. So then I talked about some of the red death that happened, and one of the short stories by Edgar Allan Poe, Mask and the Red Death, and how a plague organism entered into the castle and responsible for killing all the people. And then they tried to find the person wearing the mask, and they found that they could not address anything. So this is simply a virus that has entered the system and responsible for the killing of all those people. Then I talked about the Ingmar Bergman movie, and how the pulse of anxiety is still very much in our mind. So this is a character of death in the right hand side, started playing chess with another person. Likewise, the death is unavoidable and inevitable, so therefore, simply by delaying the process of inevitable, unavoidable. So also anxiety is very much in our mind. So there are many successive waves of extraordinary epidemics that has happened, starting from bubonic plague, smallpox, tuberculosis, the cholera, the Eurofever influenza, and COVID-19. So we have survived all these epidemics, and we also survived this epidemic as well. So this is a Hakushi painting by a Japanese painter. And you can see a lot of tiny boats with their fishermen. And they are simply seeing the giant wave. And this giant wave simply is a kind of epidemic. And we have no other choice because we don't have any medicine, we don't have any vaccine. So therefore, we do not know actually how to combat this kind of situation. So simply we are facing a giant wave now in relation to this kind of situation. So all these infectious diseases, 60-70% of the infectious diseases are of animal origin, and there are two different stages that adapt to the human, from the stage 1 to stage 2, stage 3. From animal to human, and in the space, the final stage, the deep space, where it is transmitting from the human to human. So therefore, it is basically human to human, human to human transmission that is the COVID situation. So June Almendio is a daughter of a Scottish bus driver who discovered this virus. She was an electron microscopist. And through electron microscope, she showed that this crown-like structures around the virus, and from there it is named as the coronavirus. And these are the picture of the coronavirus. There is a lot of spike proteins on their surface. And there are a few number of proteins are present in the virus, like spike protein, nuclear protein, M protein. And these are the proteins present in the virus. And spike protein is the important protein for vaccine development. Like Oxford vaccine, they have found spike protein in the adenovirus system, and they are trying to use this as a vaccine candidate. Now, how virus enters the cell? So virus has a spike protein on their surface, and we have a specific receptor on the lung cells that is called the ACE2. That is angiotensin converting enzyme 2. And there is a specific interaction of angiotensin receptor with this coronavirus spike protein. And ultimately, it enters into the host cell. So this is a cartoon to show that the receptor spike protein, and this spike protein has two subunits, one is the S1 and S2. And this is specific receptors of the host cell, ACE2. And this specific interaction is important for entering this viruses into the process. So this is a paper published in Nature Medicine where the entire sequence of coronavirus has been given, and that has been compared with the other coronaviruses. And we can see that you won't be able to see very clearly, but one thing I want to show you, that if you look at the structure in and the upper one, that is some specific sequences, and this sequence is absent any other viruses. So there are few other pictures to show this kind of differences. Now, this is a picture showing that single-letter amino acid sequences in the SARS virus and the pangolin of 2. And this sequence, the L is in the box, and the amino acid letters. So KFQSNY, and this is the amino acid sequences important for interacting with the receptor, with the C2 receptor. And you can see these amino acid sequences are present in the pangolin and also in the SARS-CoV-2 that is infected human, but this sequence is absent in the bat. So therefore, in all probability, this sequence possibly derived from the pangolin sequences and virus present in the pangolin, and that is probably the SARS-CoV-2 probably adapted or taking these sequences from the pangolin. And another important feature of this virus, that is the purine recognition model. Purine is a proteolytic enzyme that are present in our system. And this enzyme is responsible for making this, cleaving the spike protein into S1 and S2. So this sequence is present only in the COVID-19. Here is the sequence from the Wuhan to USA to China to Japan. It is only present in the SARS-CoV-2, not any other viruses. So this is a unique sequence that is present in the SARS-CoV-2. And this is important where the proteolytic enzymes can act and responsible for getting this spike protein into S1 and S2. And S2 is important for the fusion of the host cells, and S1 is important for entering into the host cells, and therefore this cleaving is important for entering the virus into the host cells. So coronavirus protein has been mapped, the spike protein, SARS-CoV-2, ARBR, multibasic S1, S2 sites. The host cell protease cleaving cleaves the SARS-CoV-2 spike protein at S1, S2 site. And cleavage of S1 and S2 site is essential for spike-driven virus entry into lung cells. So therefore, entering into the lung cells, the spike protein must cleave into S1 and S2, and that is important for entering into the host cells. So what is the pathology, and what kind of pathology is seen in this infection? We know that 85% to 90% of the people, they show mild infection. About 10 to 15% of the people, they show kind of severe infection or severity of the disease. So this round one is the alveoli, and virus is entering into the alveoli and interacting with the host cells. And that can produce a variety of cytokines. Probably you are very much aware of this cytokine storm. Alveolar cells that is responsible for interacting with the SARS-CoV-2 and producing wide variety of cytokines. And from mild disease, if this cytokine production is very high, then it can go to the severe form of the disease. So for severe form of the disease, variety of cytokines are produced. And this is responsible for organ damage, and not only organ damage, causes hemorrhage in the alveoli. So therefore, it affects the gas exchange, and ultimately patient die because of this alveoli loss. So the major questions till now remains that what is the biggest unanswered question in this system? Why some develop severe disease? Why is other fever? So this is the biggest question in this COVID infection. that why some people develop mild infection, about 90% of us develop mild infection, and 10% of us really develop severe disease. So this is an unanswered question that has no convincing answer until now to address this kind of problem. But conventional wisdom based on overall immunity cannot really explain this broad spectrum disease presentation. So disease presentation cannot explain on the basis of immunity that we see in the baseball. So although there are reports that antibodies can offer protection, but picture is changing as new and new information coming up. Possibly there are different types of T cells present in our system, that is cytotoxic T cells, non-endogenous T cells, NK cells, and these cells are also playing a very important role in the protective processes. So this is still a very biggest question in immunology, as well as still an enigma, that why some people can go for severe form of the disease, but some are really can display the mild form of the disease. Still, there is a convincing answer to address this kind of problem. So this is a kind of from January 21st to September 14th picture in the United States, to Brazil, to India, to Mexico, UK, Spain, South Africa, Germany, China, India, and South Korea. And you can see that the death rate is progressively increasing, but many other countries like South Korea, China, they are kind of fairly stabilized. So whatever the mechanism they have adapted, we do not know. But in some countries, it's very much well stabilized. We know that many of the countries like Germany, they are very controlled, they are vigilant, controlled very well the disease. But interestingly, in Kenya, the frequency of the disease is very low. So whether gene pool that we have has anything to do with the difference that we see from the Kenyan population to population that we see in the different parts of the world. Now, how we can really regain the concepts, regain the paradigms? So we know that the COVID in the form of Saturn that really expelled Adam and Eve from the Garden of Eden. So now we can regain the parasite. So only choice we have, we do not have any choice at the moment. But because we do not have any vaccine, we do not have any drug against this virus. Perhaps you know that the concept of herd immunity, the concept of herd immunity is started. It was written by Thucydides, the Athenian, the Greek philosopher, in 430 BC. He first proposed the concept, that concept not in the form of herd immunity, but Bob Sider wrote an article in Nature sometime in 2002, that it was with those who had recovered from the disease that the sick and the dying found the most compassion. Those knew what it was from experience and had now no fear of themselves, for the same men never attacked twice, never at least fear. So this is Thucydides from his observation that those who had mild infection, they are really protected from subsequent infection. So Thucydides was first to recognize the importance of immune memory to protect us from the subsequent attacks. So that is the concept of herd immunity that is coming in the population, and this is culture of Thucydides, the philosophy. So what are the vaccine options we have? What are the vaccines that are coming up? The first one is the Oxford vaccine. So what is the hallmark of vaccine nowadays until today? The gold standard of the vaccine is the smallpox vaccine, but the time it was eradicated, the science of immunology was very primitive form. And how we have really smallpox vaccine really protected us, we do not know the mechanism, but we were protected. But we do not have any reason that time to address this kind of question. But smallpox vaccine really is a gold standard of vaccine. what immunologists are trying to do now. Those people had smallpox recovered from the disease. Now they are trying to collect their blood, try to see if they can find some correlates of protection, how they are protected against smallpox, whether we can find a unique mechanism to explain this solid protection that we see against the smallpox virus. So vaccine development is a fairly complicated process, and through a lot of steps you have to go, and these are stringent procedures you have to follow. So there are at least 4 to 5 stages through which you have to go. First of all, you have to identify the antigen or protein of your interest, and then you have to test in the animal model, that is called the preclinical research. And if it works in the animal model, then you have to study in the animal model if it is toxic to some organs, so you have to study or other specific study any pathology on any organ, so you have to do some animal studies. And if there is no toxicity, then you have to come to phase 1 trial human in a very limited number of population. You can inject to human and study whether it is producing antibody response or not. This is done in the healthy volunteers. And in the phase 2, it is further extended from limited number of volunteers to more number of volunteers, and additional safety measures are imposed. And phase 3, to find the safety and immunogenicity, then it goes for phase 3 trial. And phase 3, if it is successful, then it will go into the market. The form of Facebook trial. So therefore, the process, the work is lengthy. So therefore, you have to get it across one to bring vaccine into the market. So first one is the COVID-19, is the Oxford University vaccine trial. This group is working with the adenovirus system for many, many years. I know one person there, so I know this group is working with the adenovirus system. The person who is in the COVID-19 vaccine, Adrian Hill. So I know him fairly well. So they are working in this adenovirus system for many years. So adenovirus, what they do, adenovirus normally do not induce any kind of pathology in human. But it stays in our system, but it cannot induce the pathology. But in this vaccine, what they do, they remove the DNA from the virus, and then the spike protein, which is immunogenic spike protein, and that has been loaded into the adenovirus system, and then this adenovirus is injected into human. So only a spike protein that is present in the adenovirus system that will come and produce antibodies in our body. So this is the Oxford vaccine, which is in trial, and possibly this trial will be initiated sometime soon. This is a straightforward simple. They are simple. They have taken the spike protein and they express the spike protein and then packed it into the adenovirus expression system and then inject it to the human so that it is producing antibodies. I know that some animal studies already been conducted, so now they are doing the human studies. So another platform is vaccine, the RNA vaccine technology. I think famous is the Moderna. They are taking the spike protein mRNA and injecting it into the human system, and the mRNA will produce antibodies, and this antibody will then produce a immune response. So therefore, you can produce cell protection. So Moderna vaccine, RNA-based vaccine, this is also fairly in some advanced stage. So basically, it's an RNA-based vaccine that is injected. RNA will produce protein, and protein will produce immune response against this antigen. So another vaccine that is being tested and tried, that is the inactivated virus, that taking the whole virus, and inactivated virus either from formalin treatment, and then put the alarm, and then inject the system in the human body. So this is the whole virus that you are using inactivated form, formalin-treated inactivated form, and you are injecting the system So there are three vaccines kind of people are trying in different parts of the different provinces. So altogether, pipeline of COVID-19 vaccine candidates by technology by different platform. And you can see light-mediated virus, you can see inactivated virus, non-replicating virus, replicating viral vector, recombinant vector, peptide based, virus discovery. The number you see, the number is basically the number of companies that are trying to develop different types of vaccines. So there are many, many vaccines people are trying all over the world to get the effective vaccine. I think Oxford vaccine probably has taken a lead, probably human data will come out. So people are trying all over the world to get a drug, to get a vaccine. And in a public health system, this is a monumental effort people are doing. But you can see some incremental improvement in our success. So therefore, you can, this is a picture I took it from emerging infectious diseases. The Sisyphus is rolling a round rock on top of Stephen, but as he reaches the top, the rock rolls down further. So, in a coronavirus of any other system, despite this monumental effort that Sisyphus is doing, there is an incremental improvement in our success. We are now, although we do not have a specific drug for coronavirus, but now we know that we are introducing steroids, we have introduced anticoagulants, we have introduced HIV medicine like which is called. So therefore, there is an incremental improvement in developing drug, we are using drug facility for cost of different purpose altogether. So despite the darkness in the world, Titan emerging Sisyphus performing the upper offering task. So we are doing something to combat the disease by designing vaccines, designing new molecules. So we have evolved defenses against various pathogens, but not against all, but because pathogens have their own evolutionary agendas. Sometimes virus will mutate, so therefore this mutation is difficult to combat sometimes. We are producing antibodies against certain sites, but because of the mutation of certain sites, specific sites, the antibodies do not work. So there are reports coming up that antibodies can escape coronavirus as well. So this is an additional problem to think of, that how to really combat this kind of issues. So this is my last slide to show. I'll tell you a story that was published in the Emerging Infectious Diseases. This is a famous painting by Salvador Dali. And this is a story about some hope. There is a long lived that is called hope. In this picture, what we see is an olive tree. Olive tree is a kind of symbol of peace. And Dali places his own image, a melting face, you can see the melting face, and draft over a tree that once really nourished this nourishing this character. But despite the destruction, the symbol of hope appears on the artist's head. That is some spider. So this Dali inserts his daddy long leg, that is the character of this spider. On his head. So this is a story, this is one famous story called Daddy Long Leg. Some of you have must have studied. This is an American writer, Jane Webster. So when she was growing up in an orphanage, and she used to write stories, poem, and one of his stories was somehow being managed to get into the hand of the benefactor. And he was very impressed to study the story because then he wanted to help his girl by providing the college fees. And the condition was that she will write every day a story, but in return she cannot expect any mail from him. So once she could see his benefactor from the back, and that person had a long leg. So the name of the story was very long leg. That is a kind of some kind of hope. So in this picture of Salman and Delhi, you can see spider having the long leg. That is some kind of hope. So as the new virus comes, so that is the opportunity for new leaders. And public health burden increases, the opportunity also increases for new research, new vaccines, and new treatment. So, all of our immunological knowledge that we have so far developed, nothing could work for the COVID-19. So, therefore, our knowledge is very limited. So, therefore, new research is needed to combat the future epidemics of new virus and new infection. So with this, I should stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for such elaborative and valuable speech.
My apologies that something happened wrong to start with.
Now I am requesting Srimati Maushali Sinha, Faculty Department of Food and Nutrition, to host the interactive session. Over to Maushali.
All of you, here are several questions from Dr. Tarashankar Maiti. And the first question is, what is the sequential role of ACE2 in the whole disease process caused by novel coronavirus?
Dr. Mohua Sheth, may I interrupt?
Yes, ma'am.
Our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Bashwat Choudhury, is there with us. Professor Shamol Rai, he was also an esteemed Vice Chancellor of a university in West Bengal. So, should we start lighting the lamp first? We'll go to the interactive session if Professor Rai gives us the permission.
Yeah, please.
Hello,
sir. Professor Rai?
Yes, can you hear me?
Actually, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Bashwat Choudhury, he was in his university, so he couldn't join us from the beginning. So, we should lighten the lamp. And if both of our Honorable Vice Chancellors give us the due permission, then we can lighten the lamp first and then go for interactive session.
Dr. Shamul Rai is my elder brother and he has already permitted, so there is no problem. Please go ahead.
We are extremely privileged to have our Honorable VC Sir, Professor Bashwat Choudhury, with us today. In spite of his busy schedule, he has been with us always. We are really grateful to him for his active support and encouragement. I would like to request our Honorable VC Sir to deliver the keynote address. Sir, please.
Today I am really in a big problem. Good evening to all of you. Today I am in a big problem because Dr. Shamol Rai has spoken about the genesis of the disease and the importance and the requirement of the vaccine and so many other things. So I was hearing a part of the lecture. I could not come at the very start. The subject that we have chosen is the paradox of COVID-19, coronavirus. Now, I could not really understand what you meant by paradox, because it is very much a reality that SARS-CoV-2 has caused enormous damage and problem to all of us. Human beings, all over the continents and all over the world. So all of you know the situation. And today I'll be very brief also, because I have one job at 8 o'clock. So I'll be brief today in this address. Dr. Shyamal Roy has spoken very nicely what that is going on. All of you know that because of this pandemic, this disease is very infectious, and it is causing a lot of infection, and that is why people have been asked to be in the confined houses. So that is basically requirement that has been put on all of us. A lot of people have died also. But in our case, with the population concentration or population density that we have, we are not in a position to allow this death rate to go very high. And death rate is indeed not very high for this COVID-19, SARS-CoV-2. For the MERS or for the SARS disease in the year 2011-12 and 2003, the death rate was close to 10%. For this disease, the infection rate is very high, but the death rate is small. But the pressure on the public healthcare system is very large for this particular disease, and that is why the government has stated that it is necessary to be in a state of confinement. So all of you know this. A situation has come where people are really working on vaccine, but vaccine research is not very easy. Vaccine research takes a lot of time, and one needs to be very, very careful. One needs to be very, very careful in terms of giving a vaccine to the persons who are suffering. So naturally, to the persons who are suffering or who are not getting this disease, I mean to preventive vaccine, if it is preventive vaccine. So the point is, in this backdrop, a lot of work is going on, but we have still not got the vaccine. We have this pandemic being caused, and second pandemic is being caused in Europe. In some places, it is facing the lockdown and things like that. So it is a disease that is putting the human beings, the most ingenuous, the most creative human beings, the most talented human beings, to our confined situations. That is what it is. That is what we are in. So I really cannot understand why the paradox. Paradox is about the civilization. Paradox is that, you know, we have so much of knowledge and so much of science and technology. But in spite of that, a small virus still can cause havoc. So that is what paradox is all about. When we consider ourselves to be the most powerful, the smallest, tiniest thing can really cause a lot of problems in our society and our well-being. So that is indeed a paradox, that, you know, the person or a human being at the top of the ladder of the civilization can be threatened even today, in spite of all its all the technology and engineering and science in its capacity or in its hold, cannot control a small virus. So that is indeed a paradox. And this paradox really, you know, the name paradox, it did not occur to me until I saw this particular webinar subject. And that subject is, you know, the paradox of COVID-19. Yes, it is a paradox. We consider ourselves to be very powerful, but the point is, when we face this COVID-19, SARS-CoV-2, we are powerless. We do not know what it is. So that is what I would like to say. I am indeed grateful that you have called me to speak over here. the actual speaking will be has been done by Dr. Shamol Roy with a lot of information and information. I am not a biologist, for the, so naturally the point is, you know, what I say on this particular scientific seminar, that will not be very appropriate. The best lecture has been delivered already by Dr. Shamol Roy, and there may be some other speakers, so they will speak. I just wanted to understand the paradox, what you meant, and I know that Dr. Roy's lecture has been fantastic, particularly the Salvador Dali's picture, the way where he was explaining, I was really moved. It was very great. So, you know, in this paradox, I consider myself powerless. I consider the virus to be extremely powerful. And in this situation, how can we reverse this paradox where the virus will be at the bottom and the human being again will go at the top? So it is basically now going back to the ladder. That is basically the question. So I will not prolong my lecture today. Thank you very much for inviting me. Stay safe, take care, and take all precautions. Thank you very much, Dr. Shoma Ghosh. Thank you very much, Dr. Shamol Roy. Thank you very much, all the participants. Thank you very much, all the scholars and the students, for inviting me to this webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your excellent speech, valuable speech. Thank you, sir. It is an honor to have you today between us. Please accept our sincere thanks, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Now, I would like to request Srimati Moushali Sinha to continue the interactive session. Over to Moushali.
Thank you, Mohadi. Sir, I like to repeat the question received from Dr. Tarashankar Maiti. What is the sequential role of ACE2 in the whole disease process caused by novel coronavirus? Over to you, sir.
Sir, Professor Roy. Can you hear us, sir? Sir, can you hear me?
Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Moushali, please repeat the question.
The question is, what is the sequential role of ACE2 in the whole disease process caused by novel coronavirus? Over to you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So the answer is that the ACE2 is a receptor from the spike protein. Right? So spike protein has two components, S1 and S2. The ACE2 receptor, the S1 part of the spike protein binds with the ACE2 receptor, and then S2 is important for adaptation. So, and then the protease works, the purine type of protease work, and that keeps S1 and S2. Okay, so these two part of the spike protein. So this purease is important. Through one part it can bind, through another part it can enter into the host cell. So it enters into the host cell because it is being cleaned by the pendant like proteases. And then can virus gain access to the host. So the question is that what is the mechanism of entry? There may be multiple mechanisms, what may be the processes. And there are other mechanisms like changing the membrane fluidity of the host cells. So by phenocytosis, there are many mechanisms through which the virus can enter into the host cells. So unless it is cleaned by cleaving proteases, S1 and S2, then virus will not be able to enter that efficiently into the host cells. So this is in brief the sequence of events that is related to the virus infection. Is it clear? Hello.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Okay,
Moshali, Moshali, may I request all the participants to mute their microphone or switch off their mobile if it is besides them, because sound is echoing. It is my earnest request to all the honored participants to mute their microphone and switch off their mobile or keep it aside, because we want to hear from Professor Rai. Sound is echoing, please. Moshali, continue.
Yes, ma'am. Then the second question is, what is the signaling pathway for the production of interferon gamma?
So I could not hear the question properly. Would you repeat it?
Moshali, please repeat. Please
What is the signaling pathway for the production of interferon gamma after infection of coronavirus?
Well, the coronavirus, it's a tricky question, because we do not know what is the signal. Number one, it may have sequences. There are two types of cells which can produce interferon. One is the T cell, and another cell type, maybe T cells, can also produce interferon gamma. The T cells are the major source, cytotoxic T cells, is the major source of the interferon gamma, and as well as NK cells as well. So the virus, it is believed that virus may have a super antigen. Super antigen is that it can bind to the T cell receptors directly. So still it is a hypothesis that these viruses can directly activate T cells, and that is the mechanism by which it can induce new surge of interferon gamma. Okay, so it's still very unclear and unknown how the cytokine signaling actually initiates by the COVID-19 virus. Okay. Clear?
Okay, sir. Moshali, any more questions?
No, there are no questions.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your amazing presentation. And in spite of your busy schedule, you have enlightened us with such an informative and scientific speech with lasting impression. Please accept our sincere thanks, sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Thank you, sir. Now we are going to start the second scientific session. In this session, our honorable speaker is Professor Pratiti Ghosh, Professor and Head, Department of Physiology, West Bengal State University. At first, I am requesting Srimati Munmun Kundu, Faculty Department of Botany, to formally introduce Professor Ghosh. Over to Munmun.
Thank you, Mohadi. Today, we are pleased to welcome and formally introduce Professor Pratiti Ghosh to all of you in this webinar. Dr. Pratiti Ghosh is presently the Professor and Head of the Department of Physiology, West Bengal State University. She had graduated in physiology from Presidency College and post-graduated from University of Calcutta. After her PhD from the same university, she gathered postdoctoral research experience at USUHS and served as visiting fellow at the National Institute of Health, USA. She has received a few fellowships and awards and has numerous peer-reviewed publications, book chapters, and a test book to her credit. She is presently researching on different aspects of lifestyle and stress physiology, ranging from yogasanas to P-glycoprotein-mediated multi-drug resistance. Today, Professor Ghosh is going to deliver her lecture on coronavirus different aspects. Now, I would like to request respected madam to her to start her presentation. I welcome you, madam.
Thank you, Munmun.
Thanks, madam.
Could I share the screen successfully?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Your slides are visible, ma'am.
Thank you. So now let us talk a little bit about the different aspects of the coronavirus. We know that there have been many, many pandemics in the past, which we have read from the different newspapers or from other sources. There have been major 12 these worldwide outbreaks, of which we shall be discussing all of them subsequently. And suspecting an outbreak, what is actually done is that a lot of healthcare associations, there are different mass awareness PET campaigns, preparedness, planning responses are all measured. And there are different tackling modes with respect to different countries as well as worldwide. There is some convergence in guidelines which are formulated by international bodies. And what we are experiencing at present is actually a convergence of all the past pandemics. So what happens here is that the aim is that the flattening of the raised curve without mitigation by increasing the healthcare capacity is the actual objective of any tackling any pandemic. Since 4000 BC in the prehistoric times, the Egyptian mummies, there have been, and in the Americans from 100 AD, tuberculosis has gained, tuberculosis is there in the world, which is still there, endemic in many countries, and one of them is our India. The smallpox eradication, there has been global eradication of smallpox, so it's basically not of other microbes that we have witnessed as the pandemic agents. From the 18th and 20th century of the Egyptian dynasties, we have observed outbreaks, and this outbreak was caused by variola major and minor, killing up to 300 million people in the 20th century. Then came the measles outbreak in the 4th century BC, where 2.6 million deaths occurred worldwide, and success there has been a vaccine against it made successfully, and which is given to all children presently. There was the Spanish flu caused by the H1N1 influenza virus, killing affecting almost one third of the world's population, lasting for 2 years. This H1 influenza virus, again, a variety of it, the H2N2 virus, caused the flu pandemic in 1957. That originated from the avian influenza A virus, including the HT hemagglutinin and N2 neuraminidase genes. The flu pandemic in 1968 was an antigenic drift from the earlier virus. It was made by the H3 hemagglutinin, which was new one, and it still continues to circulate worldwide as seasonal influenza viruses, affecting mainly the older population. Cholera outbreak, which originated in the Gangetic Delta of India, had 6 subsequent pandemics which killed millions of people across the world and is endemic in many countries, of which India and also Kolkata is one of them. Every year, 1.3 to 4 million cases of cholera are recorded worldwide, which caused death. Then came the Ebola outbreak, which occurred 24 times between 1976 and 2012. It infected animals carrying the viruses that can transmit it to other animals like ape, monkey, duikers, and from there on to humans. The HIV pandemic, we know about it, that it has, when the humans hunted these chimpanzees for meat and came into contact with the infected blood, probably that's the way it was transmitted to humans. The SARS outbreak was the most, in 2002, it was the most common out mode of transmission through the respiratory droplets. The flu pandemic in 2009, which is termed as the swine flu, it started with the human avian that further combined with the Eurasian pig flu virus and was just named as the swine flu. Then came the MERS, the Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, which affected 80% of humans in Saudi Arabia, and 30% with 30% fatality rate. And still date, there is no effective vaccine against any of these COVIDs. So gathering knowledge from all these pandemics, we know that we have to ban large gatherings, break channels of communication, allot separate wards, use PPE equipment, PPE for those in healthcare, go for quarantines, closure of schools, etc., 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 which we are all facing and seeing today. All of these are basically a collection from the past, from our records from the past, which now only the extra thing that we are doing is work from home, since it's a very much technologically savvy world today. We also have gathered knowledge about what are the drugs which have been effective against influenza, Ebola, HIV, MERS, and SARS. They are basically used for repurposing today. Then came the COVID-19 pandemic, which is the largest pandemic of the 21st century, affecting 213 countries worldwide. We have already seen the statistics of the world statistics and the India statistics of how many affected people and how many death rates in September till date. And the curve is basically still rising. We know that these have not come directly from humans, that these viruses do not originally affect the humans. They were either in the bats or rodents or civet cats or dromedary camels, ferrets, and Malayan pangolins, Professor Roy has already said. So these health threats from coronaviruses are constant and long-term, as we have been seeing from the past. So what are they? There are a large family of RNA viruses, and there are seven such different zoonotic viruses which cause mild to lethal respiratory tract infections. Looking at the microbial taxonomical classification of the coronaviruses, we find here that they are ultimately divided into four classes. Alpha, beta, the phylogenetic tree would show them to be alpha, beta, gamma, delta, of which the beta coronaviruses are of most concern to us since they have fatal effects. The SARS-CoV, the MERS, the murine coronavirus, MHV, and the BCoV or the bovine coronavirus belong to the beta coronavirus group. And the gamma and from the gamma coronaviruses, which affects specifically the birds and also the beluga whale, the delta coronaviruses affects the mammals as well as the birds. So what is special about these coronaviruses? In their corona or their crown, they have those spikes to which they get attached to their, with the subunits, they get attached to the cells and takes control of the cell totally. The special thing about this SARS-CoV-2, that is the one responsible for the COVID-19, is that this new virus binds more strongly than SARS does to the cells, or rather SARS pandemic did to the cells, even though the spike shapes are similar. What is special is that the genome of this virus lacks the hemagglutinin esterase gene, which is characteristically found in this beta-CoV lineage. The structure of human coronavirus here this time, this is the SARS-CoV-2, the present one, the SARS-CoV, the earlier one, and the MERS-CoV, the Middle East Respiratory Syndrome disease. These genomes are basically, all of them are similar with minor differences. Here we see the other beta coronaviruses. So basically the typical form of all the coronaviruses we know is their the S glycoprotein imparts their shape, the M glycoprotein are the regenerating virions, E glycoproteins are responsible for assembly and morphogenesis of the virions, and the N proteins for the replication and transcription, and whereas the HE is normally used as the invading mechanism. This would be the schematic signaling pathway. There is the alpha coronavirus. Starting with the alpha coronavirus, we will see gradually that the HCoV-229E, it is all of these infections are mainly restricted to the respiratory tract. So the exudates of the nasal mucosal plasma contain a lot of interferon gamma, and they peak within the first 3 days after infection and drop dramatically off at 1 week. Let's say we have a terminology in Bengali which says je oshudh khele 7 din na khele 1 saptah. This is what it would come down to. So the clinical features of HCoV-229E is that the camelids are the intermediate hosts originally, and they approximately last for 2 to 5 days, followed by illness lasting till 18 days. And they have the symptoms of the common cold. There is really till date no medicine as such or vaccine as such for all these common cold infections, except symptomatic treatments. The immunocompromised patients are reported to suffer severe and life-threatening lower respiratory tract infections, and they cause epidemic during winter in temperate climate countries. The treatment would be with cyclosporine A, but that is an immunosuppressive drug and is usually not advisable unless really required. The alpha coronavirus NL63-CoV shows mixed viral infections. It has relatively mild symptoms like cough, fever, sore throat, rhinitis, etc., and is mainly prevalent in the children before the age of 5, and 1 to 10% of the population annually suffer from this disease, which peaks in spring and summer. The treatment would be there is no specific antiviral drug, so it is primarily supportive treatment. Then comes the beta coronavirus group, starting with HCoV-HKU1, which again causes rhinorrhea, cough, nasal congestion, fever, sore throat, chills, post-nasal discharge, and additional tonsillar hypertrophy. It's a respiratory syncytial virus, and epidemic usually appears prior to the influenza season and is associated with the asthma problems. This affects adults and the old people also, especially during the spring and summer period. The HCoV-0343 is associated with mild upper respiratory tract infections and has shown neuroinvasive properties, especially in winter and temperate climates. For this, chloroquine is a compound that has been used. Ribavirin has also been used along with remdesivir. Beta coronavirus MERS-CoV affects the respiratory tract and is found in the serum, stool, and urine. It affects the extrapulmonary areas also. It causes fever, myalgia, chills, followed a few days later by non-productive cough and dyspnea, showing symptoms of vomiting, diarrhea, or even abdominal pain, which we have also seen in certain cases of COVID-19 patients. Diagnosis of MERS-CoV would be asymptomatic to acute respiratory illness with mild to severe respiratory courses, and since it is acute, it quickly leads to death. There is still date no vaccination or treatment against it, only supportive therapy is available. An administration of both ribavirin and interferon alpha 2b may decrease the viral load. Beta coronavirus SARS-CoV, the pathogenesis is that it would be down-regulating. It is basically the original mother strain of our present virus. So there is down-regulation of ACE2, the adaptive immune system, the innate immune system, recruitment of immune cells, everything is disrupted. It disproportionately affects the adults, who typically manifest fever, myalgia, headache, malaise, chills, and non-productive cough, similar to the earlier coronavirus infections, as well as the present one. 25% of the affected patients develop watery diarrhea and respiratory distress, not all. It is approximately 10% with most deaths occurring in the third week of illness. the case fatality rate for older persons more than 60 years of age approaches 50%. Those younger than 12 years of age have also a range of symptoms, but they resolve more quickly than in adolescents and adults. The treatment would be with chloroquine or remdesivir. Now comes the novel corona SARS-CoV-2 virus. The pathogenesis of both of SARS-CoV and CoV-2 are similar through their spike protein. And there is the diagnosis with a whole range of diagnostic criteria, which we all know by this time from the TVs and newspapers, etc. Then there is the beta coronavirus B-CoV, which is predominant in the cattle and wild ruminants. It is a pneumoenteric virus, that is, it affects the lungs and the gut. It is mainly prevalent in winter and is a wasting disease sometimes also. Cause wasting disease in swine. This would be how respiratory beta B-CoV looks. The clinical sign and pathogenesis of respiratory B-CoV are all almost similar, only that with the diagnosis and with the deviation of a little bit of the symptoms, they are all mostly similar. Then comes the gamma coronavirus, which we are really not much interested in, as they are still being restricted to different kinds of the animal world. So the infection in human, the first four of them, they infect, their infection is generally mild and people usually recover from it, and they are seasonal epidemic around the world, but in clusters. It's not that everybody is being affected with them. The others, there's the MERS, SARS-CoV and SARS-CoV-2, they are potentially similar as their symptoms have confirmed numerous cases of death worldwide. Here is a basic ratio of a comparative between all the three kinds. So the farm animals from the poultry industry, we are interested in them since a good percentage of the world population depend on meat and eggs as their source of food. So once the poultry industry is affected, it also causes substantial economic loss other than what we are sustaining now, other than what the whole world people are sustaining now. Coronaviruses infect domestic pets like cats, dogs, and ferrets through the alpha coronavirus, laboratory animals through the mouse hepatitis virus, and rats, which we use in our labs. However, the greatest amount of coronavirus diversity is seen in the bats. Case fatalities in our COVID is the minimum, has been the minimum compared to the SARS and the MERS or the MERS-CoV. So these are the common symptoms which we see in our COVID-19, with fever, cough, mild bleeding, gastrointestinal issues, diarrhea, may or may not be, with severe symptoms of pneumonia, kidney failure, from which one may recover. There is a good possibility of recovering also. These coronaviruses survive on the surfaces at 68 degrees. It lasts for 2 days on steel, 4 days on glass on wood, 5 days on metal, plastic, and ceramics. Though one strain of SARS lasted up to 9 days on plastic, 2 to 8 hours on aluminium, and less than 8 hours on latex. The non-porous surfaces like doorknobs and tabletops are better at carrying viruses in general. Porous surfaces like money, hair, and fabric, they do not allow the viruses to survive for long. But the smooth surfaces like plastic, stainless steel, glass, ceramics, lattice, they hold on to the virus for up to 7 days. The temperature changes would have a high effect on the lipid layer of the coronavirus. A sudden jump at 18 degree Fahrenheit from 68 to 86 decreased how long the SARS could last on the steel surfaces. But it can be inactivated within a minute by disinfecting surfaces with 71% alcohol or 0.5% hydrogen peroxide or bleach containing 0.1% sodium hypochlorite. It could be tickled by temperatures above 56 degrees centigrade at a rate of about 10,000 virus particles every 15 minutes. Then there are the treatments for coronavirus. Let us start with the most mild forms of the Ayurvedic treatment. There are different paniyas, haritakis, and nasyas available for it. And the Yunani treatments, and which are all recommended by the Ministry of Ayush for the treatment and prevention, especially of coronaviruses. There are the homeopathic and the herbals, where Arsenicum album 30 had gained popularity initially. Presently, the turmeric, tulsi, ashwagandha, etc. also have good popularity till date. Then comes the herd immunity. If a lot of people have already are infected by this coronavirus or by any microbe or by any disease-prone microbe, then initially the initial figure shows that there is no immunity and a lot of people are infected by it. With time, as more number of people are infected by it, let us say it is by 60 to 85% of the population is infected, already infected, has once been infected by it, then it would restrict the rest of the population from being infected to a good degree, but not completely. This can be done artificially by vaccination also. So if a vaccine is already administered to a major section of the population, the others who have not taken the vaccine shall also benefit from it. Such has already been the case in case of diphtheria, measles, mumps, pertussis, polio, rubella, and smallpox, but not in influenza, as we have seen. It always affects in every year. The different parts of the virus may act as parts of the vaccine, and as already been as discussed elaborately by Professor Roy, there are many are in the market. Many are in the different phases of clinical trials, and most of them are not live ones. There are the mRNA vaccine is the first one of its kind. And the adenovirus type 5 vector is also the second one in the race. These are mainly been made by the non-profit organizations, public, academic, private, and industries from North America, China, Europe, Asia, and Australia. But there's a difference between the making of these COVID-19 vaccines as opposed to the classical vaccines that are used, which take a lot more time to be synthesized. So how are these COVID-19 vaccines getting the clearance from who? With billions of doses throughout the world? It is because none of them are live, and they taking 2 years to develop the vaccine would really not have any use. Probably not have any use, though there are many pandemics which had six waves in different throughout many years. But still, it is being tried that if it can help us. They would generate antibodies that would promote an aggravated form of the disease. And those SARS and MERS vaccines could not be generated. But instead, sometimes they had led to more severe forms of the disease when the virus was subsequently inoculated. It's known that it has to be not only safe, but also effective. Nevertheless, the vaccines do generate immunity to the vaccinated people at least. So what is the basic immunotherapeutic profile of the COVID-19 patients? They need to enhance their lymphocytes or inhibit inflammation. Enhancing lymphocytes may include the NK cell-based therapies, immunomodulators, or convalescent plasma therapies. And to check the inflammation, it could be done by mesenchymal stem cell-based therapy, regulatory tract cell-based therapy, blood purification, blockade of IL-6 signaling, JAK inhibitors, etc., etc. So NK cell therapies has gained a lot of prominence against cancer cells. So immunomodulators used against hepatitis B and C virus are IFN alpha 2A and 2B, interferon plus ribavirin have already been initiated for patients in COVID-19. And Pseudomonas aeruginosa and thymosin may also be effective. We all know that the polymerase inhibitor of heme, hydroxychloroquine, which is used in the treatment of malaria and systemic lupus erythematosus and rheumatoid diseases, is an has anti-inflammatory effect on IL-6, 17, and 22 cytokines. So is also has also been used in COVID-19. The protease inhibitors like lopinavir, ritonavir combinations. Used in SARS-CoV and MERS-CoV infections have also been used here, and dorunavir in case of which was used in HIV infection has also been used here. Ribavirin from MERS-CoV, favipiravir from influenza, H1N1, Ebola, remdesivir from Ebola, and Arbidol or umifenovir from SARS have also been used here as nucleoside inhibitors and analogs. Regarding convalescent plasma therapy from patients who have recovered from COVID-19 infection can be used as therapy for other COVID-19 patients where the antibodies present in the plasma may inhibit the viremia. The stem cell therapy would involve transplantation of the mesenchymal stem cells with self-renewal and multipotent properties with anti-inflammatory effect that would defend against the cytokine storm, repair the pulmonary epithelial cell damage, and promote the alveolar fluid clearance. Tract-based therapy can also be done to inhibit the inflammation. A lot of other anti-inflammatory agents and drugs have also been used here. The IL-6 signaling can be stopped by, can be retarded by tocilizumab, which is normally used in juvenile idiopathic arthritis. And other medicines which are this basically drug repurposing using other drugs because the new drug cannot be synthesized in such a small time. So, but there are some new drugs which are under synthesis, hasn't yet been tried, all are under clinical investigation with promise against SARS-CoV-2 because by this time we have already understood that these coves already keep on perpetuating in the world throughout the year. So it is, but if possible, it is good to have a medicine against it. We know about UK's AstraZeneca's Covishield and Covaxin by Bharat Biotech, and they are both under serious consideration. So what lies ahead? Maybe we can say it in the words of Charles Darwin and Jean-Baptiste Lamarck, who were the proponents of the theories of evolution, which always insisted on survival of the fittest with a changing environment. Not all fall prey to these pandemics. Only those who possess the deviated metabolism due to multiple comorbidities or have a deviated trend in immunogenic potential, only they often succumb to these diseases. We know that he who has health has hope, and who has hope has everything. And immunity decreases with loss of hope, with fear, with stress. Anyway, with the lockdown, with the worldwide lockdown, there had been some promising changes in the environment, in the clarity of the air, water, and earth. This is the picture of Kolkata skyline, the smog-free Delhi, the lockdown, the clean air in lockdown due to lockdown in Bangalore. This is in Wales, UK, where the herds of mountain goats have come over to the roads. This is the satellite picture of China. This is the Italy's air quality where all other animals have also come out. The San Francisco, Los Angeles, the Venice gondola boats where they roamed, their water was extremely dirty, which has become clear, from which we can see the fish from top. And the Japan had spotted deers, goats in Welsh town, peacock in Dubai, ducks in Paris roads, and puma in Chile. Londoners also spotted a wild fox in their street. So that's how it goes. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, madam, for such illuminative and informative speech. Now I am requesting Srimati Monshali Sinha, Faculty Department of Food and Nutrition, to host the interactive session. Over to Monshali.
Thank you, ma'am. There is a question in chat box. Is plasma therapy really helpful for combat to COVID? Over to ma'am.
So plasma therapy, convalescent plasma therapy is helpful as per the tests from China. Actually, China has only conducted those convalescent plasma therapy tests, and they have found it to be successful. But it has not been conducted anywhere else, and people do not want to do it. People, or let's say, neither the doctors nor the patients are trying it. But China claims it is useful. That's it.
Now, I see another question from Dr. Buddhi Tiwari. How long the virus remains in our clothes? Over to madam.
In our clothes. Clothes. It's 4 to 5 days. 4 to 5 days.
Okay, any more questions, Monshali?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you very much, madam, for your excellent and insightful presentation.
Sorry, Mohadi, for interruption. There is a question in the chat box, I think.
Just now, the question is put in the chat box. Is NK cell able to discriminate which cell is infected by coronavirus and which cell is infected by cancer virus? Over to Pratiti madam.
Yes, there are so many cells and there are so many differentiations. It is not necessary that one cell has to understand. The entire immune system has to recognize the differentiation. That's how the entire thing will spurt out. The entire immune system has to recognize. It's not necessary that one single cell has to recognize it.
Okay, thank you very much, madam, for your excellent and insightful presentation. I express my heartfelt gratitude to Professor Ghosh for being with us and for sharing the knowledge with us. Thank you, madam. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now, I would like to request our respected principal, madam, to say some valuable words regarding today's webinar. Over to principal, madam.
Thank you, Dr. Mahua Sheth. I must take this opportunity to express my deep sense of appreciation to Dr. Mahua Sheth and the entire team of Physiology, Food and Nutrition and Botany Department for organizing such an enriching webinar. I'd definitely like to acknowledge the contribution and support of our IQAC coordinator, Dr. Rupa Sen, and her team, Sri Pradipta Mukherjee, convener of webinar organizing committee, and his team, and all other associated with this program, and not the least to Srimati Pooja Dash, Faculty of Computer Science, and Atrey Bhattacharya, Faculty of History, for their constant technical assistance. My special thanks goes to our Teachers Council Secretary, Dr. Pradeep Das, because I couldn't join through my net connection. He helped me a lot in the college. So this is not a formal vote of thanks, it is just and appreciation from the core of my heart. And of course, a very warm good evening and thanks to all the dignitaries and speakers, chairpersons and participants, my respected and beloved colleagues and students. It is an honor to express my thanks to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Bashop Choudhury,
who always extends his support and cooperation in all our academic, of course, in all administrative issues too. I take this privilege to thank Professor Shyamal Rai, who, despite his busy schedule, has managed some valuable time for us. This is the webinar which has been organized in collaboration with West Bengal State University, and without the heartiest cooperation of Dr. Pratiti Ghosh, it would not have been possible. So I must convey my thanks to Dr. Pratiti Ghosh, not only as an excellent speaker, but also for extending all cooperation to the Department of Physiology in Hiralal Majumdar Memorial College for Women. And after listening to all these deliberations, I found that I shouldn't trespass in the domain of physiology because I am a person from social science. I found certain paradoxes, and I'd takes very few seconds to share my dilemma, to share my experience regarding this corona paradox. The socio-economic and political landscape of India actually has turned upside down due to sudden outbreak of COVID-19. This virus has created a panic syndrome in the mind of the people across the globe regarding health issues as well as regarding our sustainability. I find that the first paradox is about social distancing, which should actually be termed as physical distancing. Society has realized that we are our worst enemies. We are the transmitters of the virus. We are xenophobic and racist regarding this potential threat. We have marked the sufferers as a class in themselves. We are unsympathetic towards vulnerables and towards our frontline soldiers. Deep mistrust and lack of empathy and compassion have placed us under the scanner to test our humanity. I find the second paradox like this, that the privileged section of the population is overwhelmed and is romanticizing the quarantine or self-isolation. The people whose economic survival is not at stake are overwhelmed with this lockdown or unlock hide and seek game activities and outcomes. We, the privileged, have strengthened our social communications by devoting more time on social network mechanisms, by posting the pictures of delicious foods, while a lot of our neighbors, they are starving. They are committing suicide. The third paradox is that we are being confronted with the issues of our life choices, our relationships, our careers, and are forced to spend time with our smallest social nucleus and not the least ourselves. We are seemingly embarrassed about our routines, mindless excesses, our self-actualization needs, and our ego trips, which have suddenly appeared as irresponsible or even malicious. Fourth paradox is
resistance to accept the obvious, to accept the new reality as new normal, resistance to believe that health and economic issues aside, the virus has played havoc on our social fabric, our supply chain to our domestic nucleus, all have become vulnerable to new threats. So, it is high time for us to fight against the virus and perhaps more against its socio-economic consequences. With this brief observation from a student of social science, I'd like to hand it over to the head department of physiology, Dr. Muhua Sheth, for further proceeding. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you very much for your valuable speech. Now, a gentle reminder for our participants. All registered participants are requested to fill and submit the feedback form that will be shared at the end of our session during the vote of thanks within 30 minutes of the end of the webinar. Accordingly, they will receive the e-certificate. After 30 minutes, the link will be deactivated. Now, I am requesting Srimati Soma Saha, Assistant Professor and Head, Department of Food and Nutrition, Hiralal Majumdar Memorial College for Women, to formally convey the vote of thanks. Over to Soma.
Thank you, Mohuadi. Am I audible?
I have missed Food and Nutrition Department because our Food and Nutrition Department is the guide for all of us. So I must convey my thanks to our Food and Nutrition Department, who under the supervision of Srimati Soma Saha is really doing a commendable job.
Yes, ma'am. I admit it.
Thank you so much, madam. আমরা আমাদের আলোচনা চক্রের একেবারে শেষ পর্যায়ে উপনীত হয়েছি। একথা বলতেই হয় যে আজকের আলোচনা বর্তমান পরিস্থিতিতে বেশ প্রাসঙ্গিক এবং আমরা ভীষণভাবে সমৃদ্ধ হয়েছি। এবার পালা তাই ধন্যবাদ জ্ঞাপনের। প্রথমেই ধন্যবাদ জানাই প্রফেসর ডক্টর বাসব চৌধুরী মহাশয়কে, উপাচার্য পশ্চিমবঙ্গ রাষ্ট্রীয় বিশ্ববিদ্যালয়। ধন্যবাদ স্যার, আপনার এত ব্যস্ত সময়সূচির মধ্যেও আমাদের আপনার মূল্যবান সময় দেওয়ার জন্য। আজকের আলোচনা চক্রটি মূলত হীরালাল মজুমদার মেমোরিয়াল কলেজ ফর ওমেনের শারীরবিদ্যা বিভাগ এবং পশ্চিমবঙ্গ রাষ্ট্রীয় বিশ্ববিদ্যালয়ের শারীরবিদ্যা বিভাগের যৌথ প্রচেষ্টায় সফলভাবে অনুষ্ঠিত হয়েছে। আমি ধন্যবাদ জানাতে চাই ডক্টর প্রতীতি ঘোষ মহাশয়াকে, যিনি পশ্চিমবঙ্গ রাষ্ট্রীয় বিশ্ববিদ্যালয়ের শারীরবিদ্যা বিভাগের বিভাগীয় প্রধান এবং আজকের আলোচনা চক্রের একজন মূল বক্তাও বটে। ধন্যবাদ ম্যাডাম। ধন্যবাদ জানাই আমাদের এই আলোচনা চক্রের আরো একজন বক্তা ডক্টর শ্যামল রয় মহাশয়কে, আর ধন্যবাদ ডক্টর সোমা ঘোষ মহাশয়াকে, আমাদের কলেজের প্রিন্সিপাল। আপনার অনুপ্রেরণা আমাদের চলার পথের পাথেয় হোক। ধন্যবাদ জানাই আমাদের আইকিউএসি কোঅর্ডিনেটর ডক্টর রূপা সেন ম্যাডামকে, শ্রী প্রদীপ্ত মুখার্জিকে, যিনি কনভেনার সেমিনার সাব কমিটির। তার সঙ্গে আমি শুভেচ্ছা জানাই এই দুটি বিভাগের সকল অধ্যাপিকা, অধ্যাপক এবং অধ্যাপিকাদের এত সুন্দর তথ্যপূর্ণ একটি ওয়েবিনার আমাদের উপহার দেওয়ার জন্য। আর যাদের কথা না বললে হয়তো আমার এই বক্তব্যটা অসম্পূর্ণ থেকে যাবে, যারা দুজন ক্রমাগত আমাদের এই মহাবিদ্যালয়ে অনুষ্ঠিত সকল ওয়েবিনারে আমাদের সাহায্যের হাত বাড়িয়ে দিয়েছে, অর্থাৎ আমাদের টেকনিক্যাল এক্সপার্ট টিম, শ্রীমতী আত্রেয়ী ভট্টাচার্যা অধ্যাপিকা ইতিহাস বিভাগ, শ্রীমতী পূজা দাস অধ্যাপিকা কম্পিউটার সায়েন্স বিভাগ। আর হ্যাঁ, ধন্যবাদ আপনাদের সকলকে, সকল অংশগ্রহণকারীদের এতক্ষণ আমাদের সাথে থাকার জন্য।
আমরা কথা দিলাম আগামী দিনে আমরা আপনাদের আরো সুন্দর এবং তথ্যপূর্ণ আলোচনা চক্র উপহার দিতে পারবো, যা নিশ্চিতভাবে আমাদের আপনাদের সবাইকে সমৃদ্ধ করবে। সকলে সুস্থ থাকবেন, ভালো থাকবেন। ধন্যবাদ। ওভার টু মহুয়াদি।
Thank you, Shoma. Now, may I a small request to Professor Shamul Roy. And sir, am I audible, sir? Sir, can you hear me? Sir? Professor Shamul Roy, sir, can you hear me?
Professor Shamul Roy, are you there? Professor Shamul Roy?
Probably, sir has left the platform due to network issue.
Professor Rai, please unmute yourself, because we'd like to invite you for watering the plant so that we can live peacefully in a new normal phase. Professor Rai, please unmute yourself.
Yeah, can you hear me now? Hello?
Yes, sir. You are absolutely audible, sir.
Okay.
Sir, আপনার কাছে আমাদের একটা ছোট্ট আবেদন। আমরা ওয়াটারিং অফ প্ল্যান্টস এর মাধ্যমে জলসিঞ্চনের মাধ্যমে আমরা একটা পজিটিভিটি নিয়ে আমরা যে ভবিষ্যতে আমরা যাতে এই কোভিড সিচুয়েশনটা আমরা অবশ্যই যেন ওভারকাম করে আবার আমরা আমাদের স্বাভাবিক জীবনে ফিরে যেতে পারি, সেই একটা পজিটিভিটির একটা আপনার হাত ধরে আমরা সেই পজিটিভিটির একটা আবহ আমরা তৈরি মানে আনতে চাইছি, সেই আবহ নিয়ে আমরা এই ওয়েবিনার সেশনটা শেষ করতে চাইছি।
ওকে, ইন মাই টক আই ট্রাই টু ইন্ডিকেট সামথিং অলসো টু ডিসক্রাইব মেনি থিংস অ্যাবাউট
So, as I mentioned
in my talk that how little we know about the subject about our defense mechanisms and the new virus really a serious challenge. We do not know much about it and how it is interacting with the host and what kind of pathology is doing. So all our pride that we know we conquer the world, all the viruses, all the pathogens. But in reality, we do not know much about it. So therefore, it requires a lot of research, new ideas, new thinking, so that new ideas come. And basically, it's a challenge. It's a challenge. Although you have many ideas, many instruments to know about what are the mechanisms, what are the things going on in the system. But effectively, to design a drug molecule, it's a very difficult task in this context. Historically, if you look at the India, you have produced food drug,
then you have to go back to 1921 when Upendranath Brahmachari discovered first drug, that is euryastigmine for treatment of scoliosis. And even today, such a synthetic molecule not has been discovered. So our research in our country, it's not really as per US standard or European standard. So, always I think that even from the school to college from whatever, always we have to think about inculcate the idea of creativity. The type of teaching we are doing, I don't think we are teaching in the proper way. We need more of a mentor than teachers. Like if you think about the Omarian Epi, like when Odysseus left home for Trojan War, after 10 years when he came back, he put his son in favor of care of someone, but when he came back after 10 years of the Trojan War, he realized that his son has really developed many qualities. He's a warrior, he knows, he has knowledge, he has really developed in all terms possible. So this is a mentor. Always I feel that we need to be a mentor, not a teacher. Teaching is syllabus, it has no value, it has no value. But if you can help to inculcate the idea of creativity, I think that is the best thing one can do to the student. And that is my impression, I always look forward to it. So, for research, for developing research activities, different new ideas, things like that, always we have to know how to look and ask the right question. And always we have to challenge the regular paradigm that we can think of. Like if you talk about philosophers of science, like Karl Popper, and always, how do we know the research we are doing is correct? Always ask me a question. And actually, that can give rise to many more questions. When I was a postdoc at MIT, the professor used to tell me, if you answer a question, and if it does not give rise to 5 more questions, then this is not science. So I also think the same way, and I also teach my students in the same way. I think I am taking you in a different way altogether. And all that I want to say, that we hope for. Thank you very much.
Sir, may we proceed for the watering of plants as a sense of the positive?
Sure.
Okay, sir. Pooja? Pooja or Akshay, are you here? So, thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And we must overcome this situation. We hope that. And again, it is an honor to have you today between us. And please accept our sincere thanks, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. So, so we are ending our session now. Thanks all for being with us. Stay healthy, stay safe. Good night.